Hey everybody, it's Charlie
and Alissa
from Daily Motor, and we're here with Mazda's 2020 CX-5.
This is the top level signature trim of Mazda's compact crossover. It features all-wheel drive and the turbocharged 2.5 liter engine, which is only found in the top two trims.
This competes with other compact crossover competitors like Toyota's RAV4, Honda CR-V, Kia Sportage, and technically the Mitsubishi Outlander.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Chevy Equinox and Ford Escape are also two big competitors in this segment. And Mazda really outshines them in just how good this car looks, how well it drives, and how powerful it is. Although, it's kind of lacking on any sort of hybrid options, and it's missing some kind of interior features that many other competitors have.
So we're going to take a look around the interior, take it for a test drive, do a little bit of a highway portion. If you're looking for a full video of highway driving, we have a real-world fuel economy test right on the channel.
Which is actually of Daily Motor first.
This is the first
car to do that test, so it was interesting.
Yeah.
Yep.
And we also have a sound test video for the CX-5 as well.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right on the channel, Daily Motor.
Links in the description, testing out that Bose 10-speaker audio system in here.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, shall we take a look inside?
Yes, I think we should.
Cool. So, we got the CX-5 here in what they call machine gray metallic. What do you think of this color?
It's machine gray and it's a little metallic, so I think the words kind of, the name itself
it's accurate,
is,
at least.
Is very accurate. Yeah, it does have that kind of industrial looking army metal kind of feel to it. It's kind of boring if you ask me.
I don't know. Typically I don't like gray with just about anything,
right.
But in this car, it kind of works because it doesn't look dirty at all, which even that white Mazda CX-30 we had didn't look dirty.
That was so clean.
Right. That could have been beautiful. The wax or something though. But this color, it looks mature. This is like the only car that I don't mind gray on because it allows the lines to be like there, but sort of subtle at the same time. It looks mature. I like the wheels.
I do like the wheels with it. Mm-hmm. This finish that the rims themselves have.
Yep.
That's really nice. It does complement it a little bit. It almost has, and I don't know if it's because of the scenery that we have back here, but it almost has like a green finish to it a little bit.
Right.
Yeah?
Yep. The tires have a good amount of meat on them as well, so it absorbs those bumps quite well, which we'll see here out on the drive. Coming around back, it does have a power-operated lift gate. If you want to bring that open, which I don't particularly care for, but Alissa says she appreciates them.
I do, because I can imagine if I'm going grocery shopping or if I just have a ton of stuff that I need to put back here, I don't want to have to like lift an entire trunk open. Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah.
Now some newer vehicles have an automatic, you can just like swipe your foot underneath because say your arms were full.
That's pretty cool.
And this does not have that, I don't believe. We'll try it, but I don't think that's a feature that this one has. So it's a little dark for the trunk, but looks like the camera's picking it up okay here. One thing that's kind of cool is you can drop the seats from these little center things that don't seem to be working super well.
Is it the seatbelt?
It might be the seatbelt. No, there we go. It just wasn't releasing properly. So you can do that. And what else is cool is it actually also has 40-20-40 split seats. So if Liz wants to go up, you can push that passenger seat up and then that center one can go down. And that would allow you if you had skis or just anything long, 2x4s or whatever, or if some of the rear passengers needed to get into the trunk, you could flip that middle seat down and still carry four adults. You wanna hop in there?
I'm wondering, can you flip this middle seat here? Can you flip that from the inside?
I was wondering that as well. Let's see.
Oh, okay, good.
Right here. So there's this little strap. You just give that a little yank and
so
down it goes.
So for a road trip, and we kind of use road trip comparisons a lot for vehicles because when you own one long term, you're going to be doing some road trips.
Sure.
So if you're in a road trip, taking a road trip, and you've got your key, your kids are in the back and they want a pillow that's in the trunk or something, or they want something that you've packed away and they are not, and you can't stop. You're on the highway. You don't want to stop.
it's a little easier to reach back there.
They can get back there.
Yeah. So for leg room, I'm 5'10" and I've got a decent amount of knee room. This seat's set for my height right now, and headroom's good as well. And not only that, but you can actually recline this back seat a little bit to make it a tad bit even more comfortable.
Okay.
Not a bad place to be at all. And you do have...
Put it back to where it was real quick. Okay.
So it's not much, but it's somewhat.
It's something.
And then you have 3-stage heated seats back here in the signature model as well. And I think that starts coming on the Grand Touring Reserve. Don't quote me though.
Can you open that, please?
Sure. Yeah, a little bit of center storage compartment. It's padded so I can throw your phone, two USB ports.
Yep.
That's nice to have. Okay. One thing you are missing in the CX-5 though is a panoramic sunroof. So if that's something that you're really interested in having, you're not gonna find it here. Coming up here into the front, it's really where Mazda shines with this design. And it's gonna be tough for you to tell in this lighting, but this is actually a dark brown color, unique to the signature model. I can't remember what the name is. We'll see when we bring up the window sticker here in a moment. But this interior just looks great. Nice premium materials. The one complaint I do have from an ownership perspective is I know that this piano black material is going to get tons of scratches on it from keys or sunglasses, which you can see both of those things are right here. And I know from owners of Mazdas that this stuff just scratches and does not look great after 50,000 miles. Hmm. But other than that, the interior is mature, it's well designed, it's comfortable, it's premium feeling and looking.
Right.
It's a nice place to be.
All right, so the interior color is called Keturah Brown.
Keturah Brown. So let's take a look at the window sticker here. Is there anything of note? We've got...
The price, I would think.
Price is particularly noteworthy, yeah, I suppose. $39,000 for this one. That's including $300 for the machine gray paint, $125 for rear bumper guards, and side rails and the roof rack for $400. Fuel economy, we're looking at 22 city and 27 highway, but in our real world fuel economy test, we did find that it did a good amount better than that at 70 miles per hour. So take a look at that video in the description for those results. So I really think the CX-5 is best experienced on the road. So Liz, you want to hop in the driver's seat and see what you think?
Absolutely.
All right, let's do it. All right, let's go for a drive.
Okay. Ooh, I want to keep going in circles just to see.
Is it tight?
Yeah. Oh, wow. Like
it actually is, surprisingly. Yeah, it's
like a ballerina. Cool. Interesting enough, with that just little very slow donut I just did, the steering actually didn't feel as tight and heavy as it was earlier on the way over here. Because originally when I was driving this, I was thinking the steering is really stiff, really, there's not a whole lot of play on the steering wheel, but with that, it actually felt really nimble.
It's possible that it just has like speed adaptive steering, because it's all electronic power steering now.
Right.
It's possible it makes the steering a little lighter around parking lots, and then once you get up to speed, kind of makes it a little bit heavier.
Mm-hmm. Braking is nice, accelerating is nice.
I do really like the gauge cluster and all the new Mazda
vehicles. It is so clean. It
looks...
I love the clean... It's nice.
It is a crisp look.
Yeah.
The infotainment system doesn't look quite as crisp. It's not exactly new. The system's been more or less unaltered since, I want to say, the 2016 CX-9 it probably debuted in, if not a little earlier. But it still does work really well. The map, even though it looks a little older, responds fine. It shows you everything you need to know. A little bit of a delay. It's controlled by this center rotary knob here when you're driving. It is actually a touchscreen, but the touchscreen function doesn't work while you're driving. So when the car's moving, you have to use the center rotary knob, which is fine. I prefer using that anyway. It keeps fingerprints off the center screen and just makes it so you barely even have to take your eyes off the road in order to switch over to radio, start playing music, do something in the home menu. I think it's a pretty useful system. It's kind of like a budget iDrive from BMW.
Accelerating is nice and easy. It's effective. It doesn't feel like you're losing control of the car. It feels like you are 100% in control, and you are telling it what to do, and it's doing it very nicely. Braking is also, it's firm, it's stiff, it's comfortable. It's not something that you are worried about, like, touching the brake and just the car lurching. It doesn't do that at all. It's a nice, soft, easy brake. I would say the gas pedal and acceleration is just like that.
Yeah, and this being the turbocharged version of this motor, it's got plenty of power. You can just kind of feel as you ease on the gas to get up and get going, you kind of feel a surge. It's right. Like you're liking it to almost like a wave of power as it comes on.
Yeah, not like a fast, like, lurching motion or anything like that. It's very easy, very comfortable to drive.
Yep. Pretty peppy, eh?
It's quite peppy.
Yeah?
Yeah. I don't know if it was me or the car itself, but I was finding it kind of difficult just to stay in the lane with that acceleration.
Interesting.
And the main way that I kind of evaluate cars when I'm driving them is, how user-friendly is it? How beginner-friendly is it? Is it something that you can just get in without ever having driven this before and feel comfortable? So on a rating scale of that, with zero being, I never want to drive this car ever again, it's terrifying, this is not something fun for me, or 10, like, I could drive this car in my sleep, having never been in it before, I'd probably give this one an 8.5. This is pretty, pretty good. And I feel like I could just go on a road trip for like a couple of hours and drive this the whole way. I feel very comfortable. I feel very safe. It's just an overall very satisfying drive after just getting in it.
All right, do a little 0 to 60 launch here. Zero break.
I get up to 60. Damn.
Oh. Not too bad, eh?
No. Pretty, not too bad. Confident. A little swervy. I kind of noticed that take it off from that 0 to 60. It wasn't dramatic. It wasn't aggressive. But as I'm going and picking up speed, the car felt like it was just. Again, like, I don't know if that was me or the car itself. Very well could have been me. But, cool.
Mm-hmm. So we'll get up onto the highway here and...
Oh, good. Highway portion of the test.
Yeah.
Yeah.
These seats are comfortable, though. You're right. Spend a good amount of time in them.
Oh, yeah.
Not bad. Getting around here quite quick. You can tell by the microphone there.
It's really quiet. I don't hear a lot of the wind. I do hear some decent road noise.
This is a pretty loud section of highway, but yeah.
That's true.
I've spent a good amount of time on this car on the highway, and it's definitely quieter than the pre-facelift CX-5. The older generation, kind of earlier model years, it was, you heard a good amount of road noise, good amount of wind noise, and that was one of the big complaints of it. Mm-hmm. This one's definitely better than that. Probably one of the quieter cars in the class, but not the quietest.
It feels quiet inside the car itself, mm-hmm. Of course. It's really nice.
Yeah, no squeaks or rattles or anything.
No.
Very solid.
Feels very solid. Yeah. Great.
You can see it shows you your speed limit there and right above the fuel gauge. That's kind of nice. It's going to be hard to bring up on camera right now, but just does a pretty good job at being accurate.
Is the camera going to pick up this light up this way?
I would have to probably put it like right in front of your eyes.
Yeah, it does a little bit. I can see it in there. So it does have that lane assist, and if you have the light up display on.
Head up display,
thank you. And it has your speed as well as the speed limit, which I like. It's a constant reminder to be driving and obeying traffic laws. And when you're kind of veering in the lane closer towards either side of the lane, it will show you, and if you have that lane assist setting on, it will show you just at first the picture of the two lanes and just be like, okay, you're a little bit close. And if you stay really close to that lane,
it'll probably blink at you.
I do like the HVAC controls. They're very easy to use, straightforward. Kind of goes to that, what was it, user-friendliness that you talked about earlier. It's just, it's all, like, right there. Like, you just reach down, and it was in a natural, like, where would it make sense to adjust the HVAC? And it's like, oh, boom, right there. It reads you out, both your driver and passenger sides. You've got heated and cooling seats, which is nice. And you can just press that auto button, you're good to go.
Oh, yeah, see? The nimbleness of the steering wheel. So it's got, I like that a lot. So it feels like it's got a lot of play in the wheel when you want it to. And when you want it to be stiff and straight and heavy, it also feels, especially when you're going at those high speeds, it feels like it also has that. So it's like the steering has your back no matter what you're doing, and I really like that.
All right, want to swap?
Yeah.
So it's an opportunity to utilize the memory seat function, CX-5 signature. I don't know what all models that it includes, but on the signature model, I don't have it set, but Alissa has her seat setting set. So I think, let's see what one is. So I can just press one, and the seats adjust at least somewhat. Not as much as I need them to. But it is strange that the mirrors don't adjust. Most cars with powered mirrors have a steering, or they'll adjust with the memory seat settings. So
that would be strange. Something I would really miss.
Yeah.
If you and I own this car and we're both somewhat daily drivers of it, and I get in and I'm like, darn it, I'm already down the road and I forgot to adjust my mirrors.
And this is kind of interesting also, with Mazda's new gauge cluster, let's see if I can get in a little bit closer. There are two fuel level gauges. So you've got one there and then one here. As you can see, they're at different levels. That one is below half and this one's right at half. Earlier it was above half. So it's just kind of strange that one, there's two of them, and also that they're not exactly the same.
The passenger side also has electric adjustments, not manual.
That so is nice.
That's a really nice feature.
Okay. Yeah, no, it is. Mazdas just do such a good job, and Alyssa's a little spoiled that her last few reviews have been Mazdas, but they do a really good job at kind of being like, all right, as a driver, what do we want to experience? What does a driver want? Not what do people think they want, but like, what do we want as drivers? And that translates to just really nice to drive cars. Now, this one isn't quite as nimble as that CX-30 we drove.
That thing was a lot smaller, though.
It was, yeah. It's a whole class smaller, so yeah. I don't knock it. This is definitely still very easy to drive. And that's the cool thing about Mazdas, is you can drive them easy or you can drive them hard. They do kind of fall apart at the limit, I will say, and we'll take a few corners pretty harsh, and we'll just kind of see, like, it does kind of fall apart at the limit, but Rennie, you're going to be driving a car like this at the limit anyway, so I'm not too concerned. All right, let's do one more 0 to 60 and 60 to 0 test here. AC off. Full brake torque. Now, actually, I want to see if there's a way to disable the traction control, because there's no easy, obvious button to do it. It's not over here where it makes sense, and it's not down here. I'm gonna check in the settings real quick. Safety. Aha, it's probably. What's this? Nope. Huh. See, that's kind of frustrating. No way to turn off the. And it's not a huge deal, but you can tell that when I'm trying to get the best time out of this, it's killing the power a little bit. Let me see if it's in here. Nope.
Hmm.
All right, well, off we go. We do this.
So you're trying to turn off the traction control, is that correct?
I am trying to turn off the traction control because you'll see when we launch it right here, there's going to be a little spin, and then I get a traction control light, and it kills the power for a quick second.
Oh, wow.
And then it takes off.
Hmm.
So, anyway, here we go.
Yeah, I felt that.
Yeah, there's a little bit of shuffling around there, but, and it's probably not the shortest distance of any car in this class, but it's good enough.
That was quite a stop, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Thank God for seatbelts.
Right? They work.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You do have paddle shifters in the CX-5, which I think is pretty silly, because why do you need those? And you can also manually shift it from right here. But even though it does have manual shifting, it still shifts for you on upshift. So if I floor it right now in second, it's still going to shift, even though I'm in manual mode. So whatever, and that's the thing, is it's obviously not intended to be that sporty, so why even have the paddle shifters in the first place? Oh well, some people appreciate them, I guess. So here's what I mean.
Woo! Woo!
I mean, the tires, they're definitely not meant for sporty driving, obviously. So, even though the chassis is good...
They are complaining a lot.
Yeah. But yeah, very compliant on the highway. If you guys want to see more on highway driving impressions for the CX-5, we have our 100-mile highway fuel economy test video. So the link will be in the description. I kind of talk about my observations after spending 100 miles in the seat. Look at this interior. I mean, it's near luxury. You got your fake wood grain, you've got this very nice leather. It's a very mature, luxurious looking feel. All this brushed aluminum and everything. And they're pricing accordingly. I mean, this is the very much likely the most expensive standard compact crossover in its class. So if you're starting to kind of get up around the price of maybe a very entry level, like Acura, Infiniti, QX50 sort of thing, for the price of this signature level car, and you've got the horsepower of a luxury vehicle and everything, should we be judging it on luxury vehicle terms, or should we be judging it on standard, you know, non-luxury vehicle? I don't know. It's kind of for us to choose, I guess. Because the CX-5 does blow everything else out of the water in this class. I had the opportunity to drive just about all new crossovers, compact crossovers, on one day, back to back to back to back, 11 of them from all different manufacturers. And from all of us, all 11 drivers, the consensus, it was unanimous that the CX-5 was just leaps and bounds over everything else. And then after that, it was kind of like, oh, well, what should we put second? You know, it was kind of like a tie for third and fourth sort of deal. But it was not a question that the CX-5 was the top. And part of that's its engine, part of it's the whole package. Everything just feels good about it. So it's kind of like if a sports team is like beating everyone in its division, does it deserve to move up to the next one and compete against the bigger boys? I don't know.
That's the question, I guess.
Right, it really is. Yeah. So in terms of some of the features the CX-5 is lacking, it doesn't have wireless device charging.
Right.
It's only got two-zone climate control, nothing in the rear. It does have heated and cooled seats, and heated in the rear as well, heated steering wheel, so that's good to have. What else? It does have a good amount of safety features. The audio system leaves a little bit to be desired. This Bose system isn't the most powerful, and it can't really hold its own with some of the Harman systems on the market. So if you want to know more about that, check the link in the description for our sound system test. And the infotainment's a little dated, but Mazda had to save some money some places. So it doesn't have a panoramic sunroof. It's a little void of gimmicks, but what it really focuses on is being a good car to drive. And hey, at the end of the day, that's what you're doing behind the wheel. It's driving. Omissions aside, I'd be happy to have this car.
I would totally buy this car. I think I said to you earlier in the week, after my Volkswagen Passat finally kicks it, and Mazda's still making this car at the
sure,
time,
sure
and I imagine
be.
They would, because they're getting so much good press about it, but this I would want for my next car.
The only thing I would say is the Grand Touring, Reserve, and Signature models both have the turbocharged 2.5-liter motor, and as potent as this thing is, I don't really think it's necessary. I don't know. I'm the type who thinks if you should have your sporty vehicles, and then you should have your simpler vehicles. And the car like this, it should just be getting good fuel economy and easy ease of use, usability, that sort of thing. Keep it cheap, keep it simple. Don't worry about the maintenance of the turbo, fuel economy, everything like that. So, I don't know. I mean, when you were driving around, it's not like you needed all that power.
No.
So it was only once that you floored it, and it was like, great.
But I don't drive like that anyway at all. And it, probably somebody that's buying this car isn't going to want to be driving like that.
Exactly. And that's kind of what I mean. Is this car, even though it can do it, it's not like that was particularly fun. It was just like pushing it for pushing its sake.
Right.
So.
Right.
So yeah.
Get out of traffic kind of thing.
Right. I would choose a grand touring model that didn't have the turbo. And that only costs like $31,000, whereas this one costs like $38,000. So, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're getting a few extra features, like cooled seats and heated steering wheel and stuff, but check out the backup camera here real quick before we head out. So you do have just a normal backup camera that does not turn the lines. However, if you click here, you do have a 360 cam, and that's nice.
I do enjoy that.
Oh, and then the lines do turn.
Oh, well, huh.
That's strange. And then you go forward, and you have it up in the front. The resolution's not great, but you can see around as well.
Yeah, that's fair. So, okay, so you had to press this button.
Yep.
To have that. Is that something that you can always... Oh, that's interesting.
It's for your curbs. You can see, like, come up onto the side. In fact, we can do
it
right now.
Let's do it right here. Yeah, there's a curb up there. I'm getting close to this.
So if you're parallel parking or something, or just parking on the side of the road, you can get right to the edge without curbing your wheels.
That's pretty cool.
That is nice. What other options are there? So there's your 360.
There's that one.
Full and curb.
Curb. Okay. So I'm wondering, can you have... Like, this is the ideal option, I think, because you have your rear-view mirror and your 360 mirror.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, mirror. Cameras. As well as the lines turning when you turn the wheel.
Right.
Which is something I really like in a rear-view camera.
I agree.
I'm wondering if this is something that you can always have the camera set to for when you are going into reverse. Nope.
Yeah, I guess not.
Let's see.
Well, a little omission there.
Yeah. Well, can't have everything, I guess.
Guess not. All right. Even though you can't have everything, you can have quite a lot of good stuff here with Mazda's CX-5. So, beautiful headlights here as the sun goes down. If you guys enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button. Helps us out a bunch. Check out our other content here on the CX-5, as well as all of our other videos. Thanks to Alissa for helping out here. I'm Charlie from Daily Motor, and as always, drive on.